Amen.
Amen. All right, if you'll please stand and join us. We're going to be starting with it's actually a really fun song. It's on the Joy FM, if ever you listen to it. It's called Old Church Choir.
There's revival, and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's a rhythm of a gospel song. Once you choose it, you can't lose it. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. When the valleys that I wander turn to mountains that I can't climb. You are with me, never leave me. Cause there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy.
I know I cut that one off a little early, but that's all right. I really feel the Spirit moving me with these songs recently. And the song, I'll Live by Faith, a lot of y'all probably remember it from years ago. It's not in the hymnal anymore. But it's a very, very fun song. Talking about living by faith and not bread alone. And if you remember it, we're just going to do three verses of it for Mr. Dolan to know. But if you know it, sing along with us. If not, just listen to the message. It's all scripture-based.
Down here below, in trouble and sorrow, sometimes I sing, sometimes I sigh. But there's one thing I know, I'll live by faith in my Lord and never die. I'll live by faith, not bread alone, by the living word coming from the throne. The things I see never satisfy. I'll live by faith in my Lord and never die. Have faith in God, my Savior has said, to heal the sick and raise the dead. If you believe, you shall receive. The blind will see, and the hungry shall be fed. I'll live by faith, not bread alone, by the living word coming from the throne. The things I see never satisfy. I'll live by faith in my Lord and never die. Oh, there are times when I cannot see. 'Tis in my faith me. In night or day, faith knows a way. I'll live by faith till that glad eternity. I'll live by faith, not bread alone, by the living word coming from the throne. The things I see never satisfy. I'll live by faith in my Lord and never die.
Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, this morning, I come before you lifting up praise and thanksgiving. Lord, we pray you keep each one of us, divine presence, touch each one, use our pastor as he brings a message.
right, it's prayer time. So Pastor Chris is going to come up and lead us in a word of prayer. Children's Church, you are dismissed if we have any.
We got any kids 7 and under that would like to go to Children's Church this morning?
Mackenzie, you can go. I'm kidding. Okay.
There we go. We got one. She's excited this morning.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all might not be, but that little girl right there is excited. Y'all need to follow after her. Mr. Ed says, get happy.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We got any praise reports this morning? Amen. Praise the Lord. I seen that. Dolan Smith the 4th. Man, can you believe that? There's going to be 4 of them running around. Woo! Man, can you believe God thought we needed that much trouble around here? No, I'm just kidding, Dolan. Oh, God bless Miss Becky.
Amen.
Brownie's back. God bless him. Good traveling there. We got to... I tell you, that little girl right there, I can't never think... Aubrey. I had to think of her name there for a minute. She's a blessing. Her mama puts pictures of her on that Facebook all the time, and she's just a... She bring a smile to your face. I don't care how bad of a day you're having, you see that little precious angel on the Facebook, and God will sure bring a smile to your face. We got some prayer requests. Skyler and Talisha and, you know, their whole head of youngins. He's not quite as got as many as Mr. Kelly, but they all got the stomach bug, so keep them in your prayers. Miss Rhoda, she had shoulder surgery this past week, and she ain't let the devil keep her down. She's here this morning worshiping with us. She even got up here and played on the organ with one hand this morning. And so y'all keep her in your prayers. She does some recovering from that. And Miss Sarah's mother-in-law has been moved to life care centers in Lecanto, but she continues to need prayer. And then I know many of y'all, probably most of y'all, seen my dear wife is in Seven Rivers, and they're still running a bunch of tests, so we don't really know very much yet, but they're saying it's inflamed intestines or something like that. I don't really know all the details, but y'all keep her in your prayers. And my family is, you know, she keeps us together and keeps us straight. And you know, it's hard when your soulmate, your partner's and not doing good, and you know, it's the hardest is when your kids come in and they're not doing, you know, it hits them hard. You know, Faith was at work yesterday when all this went on, and I made the decision to wait until she got home at almost 10 o'clock last night, and she done went over there so I can tell the story anyways. She'd probably get upset at me, but she didn't handle it too good, probably because she worked all day and Mr. Kelly run her like a dog. No, I'm just kidding, Kelly. They had a rough day at work because it was 4th of July, you know, so she come home from working all day, and then I told her what was going on, and you know, she got a little upset about it, and you know, and then she's mad because, well, why ain't the doctors doing this, and why ain't they, you know? And it's like, Faith, she'll be all right. But you know, that's what's hardest for me is, you know, them not understanding and being upset because mom's not home and in the hospital and not doing good and, you know, not knowing what's going on and all that. So y'all keep my wife in your prayers. And then mom and dad are out, and Heather and her two kids are out in Texas, headed to Oklahoma for rodeo finals. They did have a flat tire one day, I think Friday. But they're having a blast, but keep them in your prayers as they're traveling. Any other special prayers that we need to... Yes, ma'am.
Over the next 3 days, we have
Okay. All righty. Any other special prayers? All righty, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for your many blessings. And Father, I just thank you for, again, for allowing us to be here. And Father, I thank you for the blessings of the rain the last few days that we desperately need. Father, I thank you for the praise report of this great-grandson that's going to be coming this December. Father, we always rejoice in the new lives that you bring to us, Father. We thank you, Father, for the news of recoveries that are being made through injuries that have happened. We just pray, Lord, for continued healing in Miss Tracy's life, Lord, and that you just continue to work in her life, Lord, bring healing and just continued work there. Continue to be with Miss Rhoda and healing in her shoulder and the things that need to happen there. Father, I just pray that you'd be with Skylar and his family, Lord, as they've been battling this stomach bug and different illnesses there that's going on. And Father, we pray for the traveling mercies of family members, Lord, of my family members, of Mr. Tom and Miss Sanders' family, Lord, and just ask that you'd be with the different ones, Father, as we've had this holiday weekend, and Lord, different family members have been traveling to and from a lot lately, Lord, just pray for them. And Lord, I do pray for my dear wife, and Lord, just pray and ask that you'd be with her as they continue to run tests and try to figure out what's going on. Lord, I just pray, Father, for your healing hand to be placed upon her, Father. I know that your power of prayer, your power of healing, Lord, and I just ask, Father, that you would touch her today. Lord, whatever's going on, that you would touch her and remove this from her, Lord, that you would bring healing in her life. Lord, I pray, Father, that you would be with us now as we come to continue to worship you and continue to just hear from you today, Lord, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we love you and we thank you for this day. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Did you know that there's change coming to this world? And the one thing I've learned recently is that change, there's a song for it. This change starts in us. And the song I chose for today is called Let It Start in Me. So if you please stand and join me.
There's a dawn arising on a brand new day. There's a strong wind stirring across the ancient graves. There's a voice that's calling, will you be set free? There's a change coming, let it start in me. Let it start in me. Diamonds sparkling where there once was shame. Let it start in me. Let it start in me. There's a change a coming. Let it start in me. Let it start in me. Let it start in me. There's a change a coming. Let it start in me. There's a revolution cavalierin' over the sea. is coming. People must be free. Feel the tides are changing. Hear the waves roll. Let this revolution wash away our sin. Let it start in me. Let it start in me. There's a change a coming. Let it start in me. Let it start in me. Let it start in me. There's a change a coming. Let it start in me.
Just a voice on that one. Let it start in me.
Let it start in me. There's a change a coming. Let it start in me.
Amen. I pray that that change starts in us today. The next song is, I'm actually a little rusty on this. The Solid Rock is hymn number 406. If you need a hymnal, it's on the screen as well.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found. Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Chris and I went to a conference once, and I can't remember what the first song was. But they threw that chorus into it, On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand, All Other Ground is Sinking Sand. I never heard that before till then, and it hit me so hard. I said, I just have to do it. I have to. Our next song is very, very famous by Bill Gaither, but it's called Sinner Saved by Grace, and it's a testimony. Hope you enjoy it.
If you could see what I once was, if you could go with me back to where I started from, then I know you would see the miracle of love that took me in a sweet embrace. Made me what I am today.
Just an old sinner.
Saved by grace. I'm just a sinner. Saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, he took my place. Now I live and breathe in freedom. With each breath of life I take, I'm forgiven. Back with the living.
that I boast on anything I've ever seen or done. How could I dare to claim as mine victories God has won? Where would I be had God not brought me gently to this place? I'm here to say nothing but a sinner saved by grace. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, He took my sinner saved by grace. I'm loved and forgiven, back with the living. I'm just a sinner saved by grace.
Saved today, you're back with the living, you're forgiven, and you're just like any of us, you're just a sinner saved by grace. I can't help but think of it. It brings me so much joy thinking of it, because it says, with each breath of life I take, I'm loved and forgiven. You're loved and forgiven by Jesus Christ, and that is absolutely incredible. I think I did all three of them, right? I kind of got lost in that one. Okay, let's close in a word of prayer. Thank you, Lord. I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for the testimony, God, that because of you, we are sinners saved by grace. God, I pray that you forgive us of our sins, that we can listen to your word and apply it to our lives and grow. And Lord, just like Mr. Red said this past week, I pray that we get happy today, that you fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we can be blessed and fulfilled, that we may share the Holy Spirit with others, that others may come to the saving knowledge of who you are. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You may be seated. As you can see on the screen, this morning we'll be starting a series. In Luke chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. And rich man and Lazarus. Rich man and Lazarus. This is a parable that's always has always really intrigued me, has always caused me to really, you know, interested me very much. And I was challenged or told to listen to a sermon this week, and I did. I love to listen to different people. Actually, I listened to a couple different sermons this week. The sermon was on this parable, and it reminded me of some different things that we need to, to listen to, or to some teachings that we could get from this parable. And I'm not going to go into that person's sermon, but as I listened to that sermon, and as I listened to different sermons, as I kind of started to read this sermon on my own, I started to get a couple of different things from this sermon or from this parable, you know, that I've really never really broke this parable down before like this. And actually, I broke it down into 4 weeks in 4 different kind of lessons, if you will, teachings that I believe we can learn from this one parable. And so hopefully you can make it the next 4 weeks and we can kind of go through this one parable. And if you probably are familiar, I've preached this parable more than once. And, you know, you've probably have already heard it or know what the parable is. It's rich man and Lazarus, the beggar. And but this morning, we're going to start this series, and we're going to look this morning at luxury and poverty, as you can see on the screen. And we'll read the entirety of the parable this morning, and then we're going to dig into the first 3 verses of this parable and see what luxury and poverty has got to do with this parable. So let's look at the parable in the whole, in the entirety, and then we'll dig into it. So Jesus is teaching this parable, and he had taught about an unjust steward, and then he talks about God knowing the heart of people. And then he gets into this parable. He says, there was a rich man, verse 19, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and he fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at the gate, full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and seeing Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in his flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receive thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And besides all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have 5 brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Let's pray. Father, I come to you this morning, Lord, just asking, Father, that you would allow your Holy Spirit to speak through me today. Father, I stand here humbly behind your pulpit, Lord, asking that thy will be done. Father, this is not about me, but it is about you. Father, I'm not here for my glory or my fame, but I'm here for you. Lord, as we've just sang, on solid rock, Lord, I'm a sinner saved by grace. Lord, I thank you for that grace. Lord, I pray that you would open the hearts of each and every person that is here today. Lord, you've brought them here for a purpose. Lord, you know their hearts. You know why they're here. You know why you've brought them here today. Lord, I pray that your will may be done today in this place. Lord, thy will on earth as it is in heaven. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Here we have the parable of the rich man who has everything. We got the man that has everything. He's got everything he ever desires. And then we got Lazarus, who is a beggar. He has nothing. They both die. They both end up in eternity in different places. Lazarus is in the bosom of Abraham, and the rich man is in hell in torment. Now, we're not going to get into all that today. You'll have to come back in the weeks ahead to hear about all that. We'll dig into those things in the weeks ahead. But this morning, we're going to focus on luxury and poverty. The rich man obviously lived in a luxurious life, and Lazarus lived in poverty. The first thing we have this morning is living in luxury. Verse 19. Jesus said, "There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day." So this rich man was clothed in purple. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't go around wearing purple all the time. But it was something back then, and it meant something. If you wore purple back then, it meant something. It stood for something. It meant that you were royalty. It meant that you may even been a king. Generally, kings wore purple. So this guy was, he was either, in the lineage of a king, or he was of some type of royalty. He was, rich. He meant somebody. He stood for something. He wasn't just, a rich person, but he was somebody. Maybe he was the governor. He was somebody in the town. We see in Mark 15 that the soldiers were mocking Jesus at his trial. They put purple clothing on him to signify that he was the king of the Jews. And in Mark 15, 17, it says they clothed him with purple and plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They were making fun of him. They did this by putting purple clothing on him, a purple robe, to signify that he's the king of the Jews, because that's what he was saying, or that's what they were saying. So in our text in verse 19, it goes on to tell us that he wore fine linen. What in the world is fine linen? He wore silk underclothing. Now, I wear an undershirt. Don't ask me why. It's something I started doing back in high school. I was in ROTC, and they told us we had to wear undershirts under our uniforms. And ever since then, I've worn undershirts. This guy wore silk undershirts, underclothing, under his, back then they didn't wear blue jeans and button-up shirts like we do in, here in Red Level. They wore more like a dress, if you will. Could you imagine walking around in a dress? Could you imagine out there pulling crab traps, Mikey, in a dress? I mean, that'd be a little weird, wouldn't it? It would be funny. I'd like to get a picture of that. Kelly, could we maybe make that happen? He said, yeah. That'd be a good photo shot. But so they had like this robe, dress. I don't know what you wanted to call it. I call it a dress, but a robe. And they wore silk underclothing under that. And only, they all wore like an underclothing under it, under their clothing. But, the rich people, the high class people wore the silk stuff. People that were, high dollar, they had the fancy stuff. It says that this rich man fared sumptuously every day. Now, I don't know where you come from, but here in Red Level, we don't use words like sumptuously. So I had to do some research, like, what in the world is he fared sumptuously every day? Now I don't, I got a Christmas bonus the other day, and man, we had a sumptuous Christmas this year. I'm like, what in the world? He fared sumptuously every day? Like, what in the world is that? So I did my homework. In other words, he lived what I like to call high on the hog. He ate filet mignon every day if that's what he wanted. He had the high dollar steaks. If he wanted to have like filet mignon and lobster tail every day, that's what he did. He was so rich that he had extravagant feast, not just on special occasions, not just on like birthdays and anniversaries and, you know, special holidays. No, he had these extravagant feasts every day, all the time. He was always throwing parties. He was always having guests over. He was always doing these things. You know, fancy dinners that we don't have here in Red Level. You know, one time me and my wife, we went to St. Augustine. And where we stayed, we walked by this place. It was like one of those welcome centers. And in it, they had these people that they'd run out there and, you know, almost attack you. Oh, come listen to our, come do this thing. And if you listen to our spill, it's one of those resort things where if you listen to their timeshare thing, you know, trying to get you to buy into their timeshare, oh, we'll give you something. We'll give you a $100 gift card. I'm like, hey, I'm up for free money. You know, you got me on the free money deal. I'll go sit and listen to your hour and a half, you know, spill. You ain't getting nothing out of me because I'm poor and I ain't buying into your stupid little spill, but I'll take your free money. So we go down and we sit and listen to their spill. They give us their card. And now they're trying to sell. I'm like, dude, we ain't got no money. We're leaving. You done gave us your card. We're gone. So we get up and leave. So now we got a free $100. Well, across from our hotel was this fancy restaurant. Fancy. I'm like, hey, we got a free $100. Let's try this place. We ain't never ate at a fancy restaurant. We go in and sit down. I don't even know how to pronounce nothing on the menu. I'm like, the lady's like, you ready to order? I want this right here. I don't know what it is, but I want it. It comes out, and it's like a sausage or something with stuff drizzled on it. Needless to say, when we left there, we had to go somewhere else to eat. I'm like, that was a waste of like $80 for two of us. And we still had to go get pizza. But this guy, he ate all the time. Then we come to living in poverty, verse 20. Jesus goes on to say, and then there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. But then there comes this beggar, and he gives us his name. We don't have the name of the rich man, but we got the name of Lazarus, the beggar. This is a common name, so don't get him confused with Lazarus, Jesus' friend that's raised from the dead. This is just a common name. Lazarus was a very common name, and the name Lazarus means he whom God has helped. That's what the name Lazarus means from those days. Lazarus was a poor man. He did not have anything to eat. And so he sat outside the gate of the rich man, waiting for something to eat. And he laid outside the gate, begging for food. He was full of sores. Now we know he's not a leper, because if he was a leper, he would not be allowed into the city. Because leopards were considered unclean and they were to be left outside of the city. They were not allowed inside the city because it was considered a contagious disease, and you're not allowed in the city if you're a leper. Therefore, we can assume he's not a leper. But here's this poor man. He's begging for food. He's sitting outside with wounds, with sores all over him. Brings us to our third point this morning. The desire to be fed. Verse 21. He says, "There, in desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table, moreover the dogs came and licked his sores." Here we see Lazarus, he's not asking to come in and sit down at the table. He's not knocking on the door, "Can I come in and sit down at your feast?" He's not, you know, begging people when they're going in and coming out. He's just wanting the crumbs. He's wanting the leftovers that are being thrown out. He just wants the leftovers, the crumbs. He's desiring to be fed. Lazarus is sitting out begging for leftovers with the dogs in the alley, if you will. And the dogs are licking his wounds. This rich man is feasting every day. He's indulging on everything he wants and everything he wishes. He's got all that he could ever desire. All the food he could ever imagine. Man, this guy's so rich that, man, he thinks, man, I want one of them, you know, souffles. I don't know, it sounds rich. He rings his little bell. Servant runs and gets it. Malachi cooks it up for him. Malachi's a chef. Went out to dinner with him the other night. We're sitting there eating. Guy comes in, hey, chef, can I go get some ice? Malachi's like, dude, I don't work here. Funniest thing ever, but anyways. This guy's got all he ever wants. And here, Lazarus is just sitting outside. He's got sores all over his body and dogs licking him, licking his sores. You ever get a cut and you got a dog and they come and they want to lick it. And it's like, dog, get off me, you know. But they want to lick your sores for some reason, you know. You hear the dogs licking him. The dogs are licking him in the alleyway because they're waiting for crumbs too. They're waiting, you know, for the servants to throw the trash out so they can get in there and get the T-bones out of the trash. Because, you know, this guy's so rich that when he eats a steak, he ain't like us. You know, when I eat a T-bone, I make sure I get all the meat off that T-bone. When I give it to my dog looks up at me like, dude, you could have left a little bit on there for me. And they kind of growl at me because I didn't leave them very much. You know, I done stripped that bone down to nothing. But, you know, these guys, they done left, you know, meat all around this joker. So here these guys, the dogs are like out there waiting for it. But this brings me to the main point of my sermon. And I know we're running out of time, but God's not looking at the clock, so y'all don't worry. The first thing we want to look at is in 1 John. 1 John 3:17 says, Whoso hath this world's good and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? 1 John tells us that how does the love of God dwell in this rich man? Well, we've read the whole parable here, and we know that this rich man didn't have the love of God because he ended up in hell. He ended up in the torment of hell. And we'll get into that in the weeks to come. But and we know that he ended up there, so we know that the love of God didn't dwell in him. But we need to know that if we have something that we can help somebody, we need to be able to have compassion on others. And I'm not saying give handouts to everyone that comes by. I'm not saying give handouts to those that are just got their hand stuck out waiting for a handout. Because believe me, I know. I've been burnt. I've been smacked right upside the face with those people. They're sticking there with their hands sticking out, and they're waiting for a handout, and you give them a handout, and they got their other hand waiting for the next handout. And then you give them a handout, and then they plaster it all over Facebook, and pow, right in the face, you get it. But there's people out there. They just need a help up off the ground. They just need help up off the ground. They just need help to get back on their feet and make it in life. Sometimes they just need help to get back going again because life got a little tough. Look with me what Jesus says in Matthew 25, 42 through 45. Over in Matthew 25, Jesus is teaching on separating the sheep from the goats. That is the saved from the unsaved. But look what he says in the second half of that teaching. And that's what I want to focus on there. The first part, he's talking about the sheep. The second part, he's talking about the goats, where we're going to focus on verses 42 through 45. He says, "Therefore I was hungered, and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you took me not in. Naked, and you clothed me not. Sick and in prison, and you visited me not. Then shall they also answer me and saying, Lord, when saw we thee hungered or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister unto thee? Then shall he answer them saying, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of these, ye did it not to me." Jesus said, you did not help those that were in need. You did not have compassion on me when I was in need. And Jesus is saying, I was that person that needed help and you didn't help them. He's not talking about the person that's just got their hand out, that just wanting somebody to keep giving them stuff. Just keep giving them handouts over and over and over and over and over again. No, he's talking about the guy, the lady, the person that just needs the hand so that they can get helped up off the ground. They got knocked down and they just need a help back up. You may be sitting there thinking, well, Pastor, I'm not rich. Believe me, I ain't either. I ain't rich. Man, I can't afford to pull a $100 bill out and give to somebody. Man, my checking account at the end of the month is in the negative some months. Believe me, I understand. But listen what he says there in verse 43. He says, I was a stranger and you took me not in, naked and you clothed me not, sick and in prison and you visited me not. How many of us has got extra clothes in our closet? Man, there's some of us, we could afford to give an extra pair of pants out or extra shirt. Man, now some of y'all might not want my extra blue jeans. They're a little stained up or something. You know, don't get me wrong, I understand. They ain't the best in the world. I understand that. Maybe it ain't materialistic. Maybe it ain't money. Let me tell you, there's a lot of hurting people out there just want somebody to listen to them. They just want an ear. They just want somebody to talk to. They just need a shoulder to cry on. They're hurting. They just need a cold bottle of water. And I don't know about you, but the last thing I want is to stand before Jesus and have him say, you didn't help me when I needed help. And in reality, we may not be rich according to our standards here in America, but you go to another country. You go to Africa. You go to the Dominican Republic. You go to Haiti. You go to one of these other countries. And they're going to look at you and you're a millionaire in their eyes. I read a story just the other day where $100 in our time, in our money, is half a year's wages in their money. $100! Man, some of us make that in like a day or two's time. Some of us make that in just a couple hours. I wish I did, but, you know, I don't. But man, I'm not saying go take and blow all your money and give it to the poor. Now, if God lays that on your heart and he says, hey, you need to go help this person, by all means, you need to do what God lays on your heart. But hear me out. He's naming off a bunch of different things here that we could do to help people. I'm not saying, hey, you're driving home this afternoon, and you see a hitchhiker, just pull over and pick them up. I don't want to read in the paper tomorrow. I'm not going to read in the paper because I don't read the paper. But I don't want to, you know, hear that you got killed on your way home from church tomorrow, you know, because you stopped and picked up a hitchhiker. You know, use some wisdom. But by all means, if God lays on your heart to help somebody, you know, You see that person in the parking lot or at the grocery store or at the restaurant or wherever it may be, and you can tell they're just having one of those days. You know, sometimes it's just, hey, have a good day. God bless you. Man, you don't ever know what that can do to somebody. You don't ever know what it can do to say, hey, can I come and tell you my story? I hope man don't mind, but Mr. Ed, he asked me and Malachi if he could come tell us this story this past week. He don't understand how much that meant to me and Malachi. What an encouragement that was to me. To have a gentleman that he could have stayed in bed that morning. He could have sat at home and drank his coffee and, you know, done whatever he does in the mornings. But he got out of bed and went and bought us donuts and brought them and made sure my figure stayed in shape. And come and told us his story. And then he left us with something that impacted our lives that we needed to hear. Something from God that he could have kept to himself. Get happy. Let me tell you, Satan's done everything in the world he could do this week to keep me from being happy. I woke up Thursday morning in one of my bad vertigo bouts. Woke up, went to sit up, and the whole room is spinning, just about puking everywhere. Sat in my chair all day Thursday, couldn't do anything. I had all kinds of things that I needed to do Thursday, and that just all went down the drain. Pretty much ruined Friday because it continued on into Friday. Was able to get out and do a few things while I was fighting it. Let me tell you, I thank God for sending people to help. He sent some, I call them pre-youth, junior youth, pre-teens, whatever you want to call them, yesterday, and some ladies to help in the concession trailer as my wife went to the hospital and has been there since yesterday morning to help in the concession stand all day long. And it was probably 120 degrees in that concession trailer yesterday. We were just dripping in sweat. There was 90 people here riding yesterday. Horse trailers as far as you could see. I mean, they were all the way down, all the way out here. It was packed. And those ladies stuck with me all day long. Didn't complain. Didn't give up. What a blessing they were. There's no way I could have done it by myself. But yet they stayed here with me. And Satan's just been beating me down. And I told Malachi this morning, and I said, you know what? Satan can try to get me down like he did Job. But my God's bigger, and I'm going to get happy. Amen. Because that's what God's called us to do. We're going to get happy. And that's what God's told us to do. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to get happy. You know, our God's big. Our God's alive. We serve an almighty God. You know, I don't know what's going on with my wife. You know, I don't know what the outcome's going to be. I don't know what's, you know, taking place in her body. I know I've seen her in the last month be in some of the worst pain I've ever seen her in. Not be able to hardly get out of bed in the mornings. It scares me. It hurts me to see my daughters scared. But my God is big. And my God can heal her. And my God is the ultimate physician. Amen. And you know what? Satan can pack his bags and go home. Because I ain't going to allow him to get me down. I ain't going to allow him to win. Because my God is big. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this day. Father, I thank you for these brothers and sisters here that have come to join me in this worship today. Lord, I thank you for these brothers and sisters that have come here to hear from you today, that have come to worship you. Father, I thank you for sending encouragement. I thank you for the ones that have reached out to pray, Lord. Father, I can't even imagine, Lord. I didn't even know I knew people all over this country. Father, a simple little post of asking for prayer for my wife, and already over 100 people commented that they're praying for my dear wife, Lord. I know you're hearing our prayers, Lord, and I already know, Father. I got faith, Father, that you can move mountains and you're going to heal her, Father, whatever's going on and whatever's attacking her body. Lord, I've got faith and I know, Lord, that you're going to heal her. Lord, I know that if there's any here today, Father, that need healing, that you will heal them. Lord, I know that if there's any here today, Lord, that don't know you as their Lord and Savior, that, Father, today is the day of salvation. Father, in the name of Jesus, that you would just draw them from their pews and draw them down this aisle, Father, to receive you. Father, we rebuke Satan in the name of Jesus today. Father, that you would draw them here. Lord, I pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would move in a great, mighty way here today. Father, I don't know who needed to hear this message. I don't know, Father, what the outcome or what the reasoning was, but Lord, this is the message that you've laid on my heart. Lord, I pray that those that you've put in our path to minister to, Father, however it is that we are to minister to them, Lord, I pray that we would stop and take the opportunity to be a light, to be love to them, Father. Lord, it may be that you are putting us there to share our faith with them, that they may come to you for salvation. So, Lord, I pray, Father, now that you would just allow your Holy Spirit to move and draw those that need to come today, Father, for your salvation. Lord, I just thank you for your grace in my life. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Stand with us and sing song among us.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is
Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
All righty. Thank you all for coming out this morning. Don't forget, Wednesday night we got Bible study at 6 p.m. We got classes for all ages, and we're studying in the book of Ezekiel. So we'd love to have you. And then next Sunday morning, we'll have Sunday school at 9:30, and we'd love for you to come and join us then, and we'll have a good time. So come out and join us at any of those times, and we'd love to have you. Yes, sir.